This is why I recorded the lecture since 48 hours, in more than 1 hour, for who are interested in this points. So the outline of my presentation will discuss and analyze some important points regarding the pharmacokinetics, adverse effects, and some trials, and I'll end with microbiology. So to start with, the calcium inhibitor is one of the great pillars in immune suppression, maintenance, armamentarium. In white state, as you see, there is a vanishing of cyclosporine. So the majority of patients are maintained on tacrolimus in adults and in pediatric. And this is the same in our center at Mansour Urology and Referral Center. We used nowadays tacrolimus and the backbone of immune suppressive protocols. Regarding mTOR inhibitors, the peak of mTOR inhibitor use was in the early 2000s, and then this is the current use of mTOR inhibitor, less than 5% after 1 year of transplantation in adult, and the same in pediatric. So this is regarding their use. What's new in the pharmacokinetics and the monitoring? This is the most important sector in the presentation. So one of the important is to find a new method for delivery. This is sublingual. This is a cohort of patients on liver transplant patients. Tacrolimus was given sublingual, and sublingual saved the money because there was a reduction, 40 to 50% of the dosage when they shifted from oral to sublingual, and it achieves better pharmacokinetics because sublingual route overcome first pass metabolism. And there are some reports in the renal transplantation. Another new issues, the usual level is done in the venous sample. How to use another way, like dried blood spot, so the patient can make finger break while he is in home, put it in a card, and even put it in envelope, and send to the lab to have the level of cyclosporin or tacrolimus. So this is another way of improvement. Even measurement of the level within saliva as totally non-invasive can be a predictor of the blood level and correlate well with blood level, as shown in this preliminary report of the tacrolimus concentration in saliva and kidney transplant recipients. The most important point is to measure tacrolimus within the lymphocytes. The site of destination of action is the lymphocytes. So this group of authors validated a method for selection of lymphocytes by negative magnetic selection, and they accredited a method, a very accurate measuring of tacrolimus within the lymphocyte. The idea is, look here, this is the lymphocyte level, and this is the whole blood level that we do. The solid circles denote the whole blood level, which is within therapeutic window from 4 to 8 nanogram per ml. Although the whole blood is very adequate, as we need, but the tacrolimus lymphocyte level is low. This means that although we give, depend upon whole blood level, this may be insufficient for our patients. Another way of flexibility, all of us know that the level should be done on C0, trough level, or after 12 hours post-dose. Regarding the extended release tacrolimus, it can be done either 3 hours before or after. So we have 21 or 27 level, and there are special equations to correct for this, and this gives flexibility to the patients. Genomics and the genetics and transplantation, although genetics and genomics are appealing, but it's still in their infancy because of difficulty, and every day we hear about genetic polymorphism. And this is the largest cohort published up to this moment regarding the genetic variants validation. And they validated cytochrome B3A4 and B5 for the calcium inhibitor metabolism. In elderly, the use of tacrolimus in elderly should be cautious, because if you look to this figure, this the black one refers to elderly, and the gray bar refers to the young adults. Here, both of them achieved the target level, but the observation is, all through the times of follow-up, the old person needs smaller dose. So we should be cautious about tacrolimus in elderly. Also, we should assess the tacrolimus clearance capacity of each individual just by applying this equation, the daily tacrolimus dose in milligram divided by the trough level. If it exceeds 1.5, this means high clearance, and high clearance is associated with increasing risk of rejection and graft loss. The most important update in this presentation is this monitor. To monitor the pharmacodynamic effect, because at the end of the day, calcium inhibitors inhibits nuclear factor of activated T lymphocyte related gene expression. So by measuring this effect, we can monitor the drug. So this is the study, randomized control, calcineurin inhibitor sparing trial done in Germany, on cyclosporin, and this is the first study conducted on this issue by randomization. And the author here followed up patients on a standard protocol on a level versus investigational protocol targeting nuclear factor of activated T related gene expression. And they found that if we depend upon the investigational immune monitoring, so in immune monitoring, irrespective to the drug level, they, so long as they are keeping the nuclear factor activated T within the target, which is 15 to 30% of the baseline nuclear factor of activated T lymphocyte, this helped the patient a lot, because as you see, infection is significantly lowered by using this method of monitoring. Moreover, the side effects related to calcium inhibitors are significantly lowered by immune monitoring the effect of cyclosporin. Moreover, the vascular status is improved. As you see, pulse wave velocity is lowered when we follow the patients by the immune monitoring. The rationale is, instead of following a blood level that may lead to a very low level of nuclear factor activated lymphocyte, this means over immune suppression, the monitoring nuclear factor activated lymphocyte will be helpful to our patients. But still, we are not there. We wanted to test it on tacrolimus, the most commonly used calcium inhibitor nowadays. And there are preliminary reports about tacrolimus, and they are appealing. And the second point is to test the level, target level of nuclear factor activated T lymphocytes in elderly persons, because in elderly person, there is immunosenescence. Regarding diabetes, this is a very large cohort of patients, including hundreds of thousands of patients. They further categorize the patients according to the immune suppressive protocol and according to the virology. And in this study, they found that in comparison to patients who were maintained on that MMF with negative viral serology, the use of tacrolimus plus sirolimus is associated with increasing risk of diabetes. The presence of hepatitis C and the CMV is also associated with increasing risk of diabetes, and this is associated with poor outcome. If the patient has post-transplant diabetes, is there any room to convert from tacrolimus to cyclosporin? This was the rationale of this very recent study. The patients are either maintained on tacrolimus or shifted to cyclosporin when their diagnosis of post-transplant diabetes was established, and the results are positive and encouraging. Some of them, the anti-hyperglycemic drug was discontinued, and some of them have normalization of plasma glucose. Regarding hypertension, there are some experimental work showing that if we can increase regulatory T cell or suppress bad cytokines like interleukin 17, this may help a lot in prevention of calcineurin inhibitor related hypertension. All of us are aware with hypertension and nephrotoxicity of calcineurin inhibitors, but we are not aware of the other rare side effects like acute right heart failure in this case. So this is a case of right heart failure after tacrolimus, as proven by echo. This is the right side dilatation with tricuspid regurg that improved significantly by just lowering tacrolimus. I know the causes are multitude, and we should put the differential diagnosis at the end of the day, if we don't define any etiology, we can think of drugs. The same of brachial effusion. So tacrolimus may be associated with brachial effusion. Brachial effusion after transplantation may be due to infection, immunological, even malignancy. So the patient should be subjected to thorough investigation. And if there is no clear etiology, we may think of tacrolimus. And in this case, when tacrolimus was converted to cyclosporin, brachial effusion disappeared. The effects on the brain and the brain vessels, there is some reports about reversible encephalopathy, and this is the another case of convulsions, and the MRA revealed vasoconstriction. So tacrolimus may lead to reversible cerebral vasoconstriction, and if we know this, we can add vasodilators that may help a lot in the management of these patients. Nephrotoxicity, this is the thorn in the side of calcium inhibitor. This is one of the experimental studies showing that cyclosporin and not tacrolimus, not sirolimus, cyclosporin is associated with cellular senescence, and this may explain the nephrotoxicity. If there is a marker, biomarker, denoting calcium inhibitor, this is one of the secreted molecules, FACIN1, that is correlated with isometric vascularization, so it may be a predictor and a biomarker for nephrotoxicity. As you see, it is correlated with the isometric vascularization. And very rapid, calcium inhibitor may lead to bone pain, which may be disabling. And if we have the patient who is suffering of the bone pain, and we do the differential diagnosis, infection, a vascular necrosis, etc., and MRI, and we don't have anything rather than calcium inhibitors, we can either stop calcium inhibitor or decreasing the dose, or even using dihydropyridine calcium channel blocker, because the hypothesis is calcium inhibitor may lead to bone vasoconstriction. And this is the same as the guideline stated of the renal association guidelines. If we have tremor and if the patient is risky for neurological, and in this case there was a distressing tremor, and after reduction the dose of tacrolimus, there was a rejection that necessitated increasing the dose of tacrolimus, and the tremor worsened again. The solution was to shift to from immediate release tacrolimus to extended release tacrolimus, because tremor may be associated with peak level effect, and this is the same as the renal association guideline suggested, that slow release tacrolimus may be used as an option as second line agent for patients who suffer intolerable side effects related to peak dose toxicity. Drug interactions, all of us are aware of the cytochrome system induction and inhibition, and this is, we are interested with hepatitis C. So this is a heat map for the direct antiviral drug and all immune suppressive drug interaction. If you find the green line, green color denotes it's a safe combination. Red color denotes the combination is contraindicated. So it is very easy, and this is from Liverpool Interactions and it was published in this chapter. But the most important article that it is in press is the effect, the long effect of anti-hepatitis C virus drug on the tacrolimus, cyclosporin, and mTOR inhibitor. Please look at this. This is the curve of blood level. So here, after 4 weeks, there is extreme reduction, significant reduction in the blood level that necessitated increasing the dose of tacrolimus. And after the end of therapy and the direct antiviral is stopped, look here, the dose still is higher than the baseline. So the key message from this article is we should give a meticulous and put the patient under frequent monitoring of the level, even after discontinuing direct antiviral, even for 1 year, because there is some interaction. The explanation is either because of drug interaction, it's prolonged, or after clearance of viral hepatitis, the metabolism of the drug is improved. The major challenge for tacrolimus is this study. This study is protocol biopsy done on time zero, 5 years and 10 years. After 10 years of the use of tacrolimus, the immunological profile is fine and body mass rejection is significantly reduced, but the most important problem is pervasive chronic changes. Hyalinosis, as you see, is increasing, mesangial sclerosis, global glomerulosclerosis, tubal atrophy, interstitial fibrosis, and even transplant glomerulopathy. That all these chronic changes are correlated with kidney function, with reduction of kidney function, and increasing proteinuria on the long term. So this raises a red flag toward non-immunological causes of chronic allograft injury, and this is why I am waiting the Professor Aymer Rifai presentation about non-immunological injury. So we should focus on immunology and non-immunological injury. Regarding mTOR inhibitor, is it a solution? The answer in very simple word, no, it is not the solution. Because this is one of the studies that was published showing that shifting from tacrolimus into sirolimus was associated with increasing risk of rejection without any beneficial effect on kidney function. And this is another, the largest study nowadays. We are still waiting the results to be published in full full article, but again, there was no difference between everolimus and the standard calcium inhibitors. Everolimus with a small dose calcium inhibitor versus standard one. To find all details about mTOR inhibitor, I encourage all of you to go to this supplement in the transplantation February 2018, and all these topics are belonging to mTOR inhibitors. One of them is cancer. Yes, mTOR inhibitor may have some anti-proliferative effect and it may help the cancer, but up to this moment, there is no convincing evidence to use them to prevent cancer. But we can use them as we use in our center for treating Kaposi sarcoma. mTOR and cardiovascular and diabetes, mTOR inhibitors can lead to diabetes either by central mechanism or peripheral mechanism. Central mechanism by suppressing the islet cells and reducing insulin secretion, or working in the peripheral cell and leading to diabetes. Viral infection, I think this is one of the important advantages of mTOR inhibitors, because there are high evidence of anti-CMV effect of mTOR inhibitors. This may be cause of anti-proliferative effect. Low evidence against the PK. This doesn't mean that we should use them to prevent virus infection, but to put it in our mind as an advantage. One important point that all of us neglect is the issue of fertility. So kidney transplant recipients should be advised that mTOR inhibitors reduce the male sperm count, leading to a great problem in men. And the most important point that we don't adopt is men. In women, we avoid them and we stop them and continue contraception for 12 weeks before allowing pregnancy. In men, men on mTOR inhibitor who wish to conceive should discontinue these agents prior to conception and replace them as appropriate. Men who wish to maintain fertility should avoid mTOR inhibitor and the bank sperm prior to starting these drugs. And these are a major limitation. In ovary, there is an association with ovarian cyst in females. The most important points, either for tacrolimus or calcium inhibitors or any immune suppressive drug, we should keep in mind drug adherence. We should educate ourselves, our colleagues, nurses, patients about the importance of drug adherence, because non-adherence is the major cause of chronic antibody mediated rejection that kills the graft. And this is why the current issue of American Journal of Transplantation put this on the cover, and this is the detailed report about drug adherence. And I conclude my presentation by this announcement that this is our site of Egyptian Society of Nephrology Virtual Academy, and we have now 3,000 lectures, 1,300 videos, and all the conference presentation will be put on the site, and thank you very much for your attention.